To see people all from the other side of the earth interested in health literacy and how to communicate more clearly and simply our health messages. So I am Helen Osborne. I think some of you are new. I don't think I saw a few of you this morning. Some of you are new. But many of you are now familiar faces, so I'm glad you came back to learn more about how to communicate your health message more clearly and simply. This is set up as a workshop, and you'll hear my style. You might already be gathering that about me. My style is, let's do all this together. Yes, I know some things, but you know a lot of things too, so let's be building on that together. The goal is that you leave with a strategy, an idea, something to try, something to do, so you can communicate health information just a little bit more clearly, just to get you started. I had talked with Andrew and Dr. Malpani about how we're going to spend this time, because I do a lot of workshops on these strategies, and I've written a book, Health Literacy from A to Z, about all these communication strategies. And what can we do in the short time we have? So they asked me, please, to prioritize plain language. That's how we use more simple and clear wording, both in print and in speaking. Metaphors, stories, and visuals. I think I will probably spend more time on the plain language and the visuals and just talk through the others. I see this as your time too. So I know there'll be a lot of questions, but we have a lot to get through. So I'm going to kind of have times when you can practice some of this. And you know, if you have something to say, we'll try to get there. I'll be here for a little while later. Is that the best way to meet your needs? I mean, I'm just trying to do it so I have some exercises. It's not just me talking, and it's sure not me who only knows one way of doing things. It's just a place to start. Plain language. What do you know about plain language? Did you ever hear the term before? Okay. You know, sometimes plain English, plain language. Different countries have different initiatives. You are from the UK. I know there's a big movement over there in the UK for plain language. There's actually Plain Language International, which in many, certainly English-speaking countries around the world. But what is plain language? Plain language, as defined by the Plain Language Association International, and a lot of this is in your handout, is loosely defined as a language that everyone in your audience can easily understand or understand on the first reading. And I will probably be talking more about print, but you can please apply this to the spoken word as well. It is for a general reading audience. It is not for those who can barely read. then you need something really much more picture-based or auditory-based, but it's those of a general reading level. And easy-to-read materials will be those who struggle to read a little bit more. Plain language is not just finding a more clear, simple word, but there's several objectives, or your spoken word, again, please. For whatever I'm talking about, put it in your own situations and your own words. So it includes organization, it includes your wording, it includes the use of numbers, your sentences, how you write sentences and do paragraphs. It also includes your tone, your layout, and your graphics. And it applies to print, it applies to web, and it applies to verbal communication. So I want to show you an example, a before and after example of plain language. Oh, but before I do, I want to find out a little bit about you. And sometimes I ask the question, what hat or hats do you wear? You know, just pretend, like what jobs do you have? When it comes to communication, I'm going to tell you about three, and you can wear one, two, or all three of them, or none. Are you a producer? Are you that kind of person who is cranking out those nouns and verbs, somehow communicating with somebody else? So that's one, producer. Are you a polisher? Are you an editor? Are you a manager? Do you somehow influence somebody else's communication? And the third one is, are you a policymaker? Do you set those standards that others need to meet? So let's just show your hands again. You can choose one, two, three, none, whatever. No real rules here. How many of you would consider yourself producers of health information? Okay, maybe a third. How many of you would consider yourselves polishers, somehow have influence over someone else's communication? Few of us. Other people too, all right. And how about policymakers? All right. So we have a nice balance. So be thinking of that as we go through those, because we are all in this one together, no matter whatever hats we're wearing, or if we're the ones receiving this information as well. So I want to show you a plain language before and after. This is from information that was on one of the federal sites for the U.S. It was from the cdc.gov, and it was from 2-3 years ago. I just wanted to show the before after example. The content doesn't really matter, but I just want to show what something can look like before and what it can look like after. This one was done back when we have the flu vaccine. You have the flu vaccine here? There was a flu going around, and it was called H1N1. Pardon?
Swine flu,
but the pork producers didn't want it called swine flu. So we called it H1N1. I don't know, but these things happen. But it was, when it got started, it was in, you had to have two, you had to have one shot, then another shot, and when it first came out, it was not available. So the media was saying, be very worried about this flu. It's a really bad flu. Get your shot. But then there'd be long, long lines around the block because there wasn't enough shots. And when I use shot or vaccine, same words, same terms. And then all of a sudden, we got so much that they couldn't use it up fast enough. So now they had to change their, you're from the media, you had to change your whole media message to, yes, you still, this flu is a bad flu, but now there's plenty. Go get your two shots. So that's the context of this. So it's in your handout too, but if you want, just put your hand over, cover up the after. Just look at the before. And the next slide, please. Could you advance the slide? This is the before. This is actually from the website. Read it either, if you would, either in your handout or up here. And just think about that. Is that easy to understand? Thank you. You have a sense of that? Okay. Now let's look at the after, which is the next slide or at the bottom. I did this, I took that information. That's what I came up with. It's not perfect. Okay, let's talk. See heads nodding. What's the difference from the before to the after?
This is simple language.
Simple language, yes.
And clear cut short sentences, easy to understand.
Clear short sentences, easy to understand. Now look back at the other. Where's the key message in the other? What?
Confused message.
It's confused. Why is the first one confusing?
There's too much information.
Too much information.
It's too long.
Too long.
Too much technical details.
Too much technical. So if you compare the two, did I leave out anything important?
No.
No. So yes, I did all those things you're talking about. That's what we as plain language writers need to do. We need to stay true to the content. I mean, we don't want to get doctors mad at us. We don't want to get scientists mad at us, public health people. We don't want to mess up that message. But we want it clear, and this was really an action. There's a few other things I did in there. The word you was in the first sentence. That's the tone. Bring in the reader. It's all about you. It's all about actions. Look at that. Last sentence. Get your flu shots today. So there's a lot that's just an example. Is that perfect? Maybe not. But what I do when I write in plain language you do is you look for those key messages. So we're going to talk about the organization of information in a few minutes, kind of how you go through this process. Does anybody here consider yourself a plain language writer or editor? No? Okay. It's really, I think it's like a puzzle. It's a skill. Yes, we learn to write more clearly when we were children, and the more school we go through, we learn fancier terms. But it's hard to get back to that simplicity, and it's hard to communicate something complicated very simply. So it's an art, and I think a plain language is both an art and a science. So the science would be the rules, what to do. We're going to go through a few of those rules now. And the art part is, how do you write something that people can understand and will read? So it's engaging and appealing and inviting as well as informative. So an example of plain language. When I talk about plain language, just trying to look at my notes and make sure that I'm following. Okay. So I said plain language is both a science with the rules and the art of just being humane and a good writer. I consider it a great puzzle. I find it very intriguing to keep looking at complicated information and find what's the real essence of what that's all about. The way to get started is, I say, it takes a team to write a readable document. Your work that you talked this morning has a real team concept. For people who weren't here this morning, they were talking about writing materials with people with learning differences and disabilities. So it takes a team. And the team it really takes is your subject matter experts, your doctors, your scientists, your researchers, your public health folks. You need someone who knows that content, or on the flu business, who knows it really needs to be there. So, okay, so you want to build your team with your subject matter expert. One is enough. Sometimes at the CDC, Centers for Disease Control, you might have a whole bunch of them. But you don't want to end with just your subject matter experts. You also need someone on your writing team who is skilled in plain language. And it is that, you know, that's what we're talking about today. At the end of today, will you know everything about plain language you ever need to know? No. You'll have a place to get started. So it needs someone who knows some of the skills and strategies and is an unceasing advocate for the reader. It's just you just believe in that reader more than anything else, and you won't give that up. And the other person or people on your team represent your reading audience. Because you know what? A lot of us do this all day long. We read health information. We went to school in health. We have advanced degrees. We have no idea what it really is like to read something that might be a matter actually of life and death. And maybe you only are reading it one time and you have to follow it exactly. We cannot bring that newness to it. So it takes that whole team. So we're talking about the content and the organization. What you do, what I usually do when I'm brought in on projects, I get the material that I'm starting with, and then I sift through what is the need to know information versus the nice to know information. Going back, you can just flip the page back and the flu information. I look, what does the reader really need to know? Not what does the scientist want to teach, but what does the reader, the patient, the public need to know about the flu shots? Sometimes in workshops, and we don't have time today, but what it might be fun for you to do is take something that you've written or you've seen, take a highlighter. And if you don't have a highlighter, just circle it. It's one of my favorite tools is a highlighter, and I just go through and I highlight that need to know information. When you do that with material, sometimes it's startling. You will see that the most important information is often in the middle. Right? It's often in the middle of the middle paragraph. Where do people read? Where do they? When you read something that doesn't interest you, you know, about your car, about your computer, I don't know, how much do you want to read the whole thing from beginning to end if it's a topic you don't like? What, does anybody read all the way through? Where?
Each para will have only one message.
Right, but when I read something, especially if I don't really care about it, but I'm supposed to kind of get it, I read, and most readers do this, you read the very beginning. The next most popular place to read? You got it, the very end. And a lot of people forget all that stuff in between. So if you highlighted the need to know information, we're taught to write, you know, in a certain way, and you get to the point eventually, it's buried in the middle and nobody might get there. You looked at the flu information. I wanted to engage the reader right from the beginning, saying, you, I'm writing to the reader, action, beginning, end, with the most important sentences. So that's part of the organization. The other thing you want to do is organize from the reader's perspective. I have seen and worked on a lot of booklets where maybe it's for a hospital, and they start off by saying, we are an award-winning facility. We have the latest and greatest, you know, cardiac stuff, or whatever it's all about. And they give it to patients about to have this procedure for their heart, maybe. What is the person, let's just think about it. You were going in to have a heart procedure. What's a good heart procedure we should talk about? Just a stent or something? I don't know. Okay, you're going in for an angiogram, right? Now you're the patient. I don't care if you're a doctor or not. What do you want to know about? What?
Success rates.
Success rates. What else does somebody want to know about?
Complications.
Complications.
Procedure.
Procedure. What's going to happen?
Cost.
Duration.
How long it's going to take for that procedure and maybe to heal from it. Listen to all of us. Did we really care that the hospital won a lot of awards? Does that need to be the very first thing that's covered? Yes, we want to know we're going someplace where people know what they're doing. But is that a given? You've already decided to go do there, right? Or maybe? Listen to that, what it's like, put yourself in that patient perspective. What do you really want to know? Sometimes people want to know about pain, parking, visiting, what to eat. you know, your readers, your users will tell you, and we can put ourselves in that situation. So that's part of that organization part. So what I want to focus on next, so just you might want to just try that with some materials either you've created or you see. Just take that highlighter, just see what that information is, and try moving it around. I really like a word processor for this. I don't like a word processor for a lot of things, but I love it for this because the cut and paste is terrific. I can crop something and move it here, put it there, and when I write, I actually do something called a parking lot. I write right on it, parking lot. And I tag chunks of information. I don't know where it belongs. I don't know if I even want it. I'm thinking maybe I don't. I put it there. And then I can look over the whole document and see if I need to add it back. So those are just some of the tricks I use. But let's look at work. Any questions about organization? Oh, the other thing I do, really important, and I did it with Anju for this conference even. This is key for any project. I always think about the end result. What are the goals? And I'm always asking, and I ask the person who brings me in, and this is for a written material as well as a conference, and I made Andrew do all this, and I don't know if you were part of it. I say, as a result of somebody reading this material or attending this talk, what do you hope or expect he or she will know, do, and feel? Andrew, can I put you on the spot? What was it like answering those questions? Because we did it for these workshops.
As far as you should know what you're
going
for, you should know what you're going in for. You should be clear about the objective, why we have invited him.
You're right.
Why, what is it that we lack? Do we lack something which is to provide information on that subject? Is there a gap somewhere that you will fill in?
Yes.
Thank you.
And I think it takes a lot of work sometimes to fill out those forms. They seem like such a, did you help fill that out too? No. It seems like such simple questions. No, do, feel, well, big deal. The no, when you look at health information, a lot of time it's all about knowledge. It's all about facts. But at least from my perspective, and I don't know about yours in healthcare, we want to be able to do something about it. Knowing just isn't always enough. And the feeling, you know, it's like if somebody tells you to, you know, eat less sugar. Unless you people feel it's important, will you keep doing it every day? So we as adults usually only follow through on things if we really feel it's important and we understand why and we know that we can do it. So I write down those answers. I look at them always as I'm looking at a project to see, am I addressing that? So so let's look at words, word choice. So plain language, that's what many people think of as plain language, or clear and simple words. What you want to be doing as much as possible is use common 1 to 2 syllable words, as much as possible. But sometimes you cannot. And there are many conditions that people need to know about. And you don't want to not use the word because it has more syllables. Well, then teach it clearly and simply. You want to use consistent wording. I think that comes up over and over again. I did a booklet from the National Cancer Institute called Surgery Options for Women with Early Stage Breast Cancer. I changed the, well, we as a team changed the wording. So we always use surgery. We did not use surgeries, surgical, operation, or procedure. They all kind of mean the same thing, but I wanted one consistent way of doing it because someone who's a struggling reader will have trouble with other uses of that word. And that goes for your spoken word as well. Follow the written, use it consistently. Now is not the time to write in an artful way, saying the same thing in many different ways. And also be sensitive to what we do in healthcare. We use medical jargon. We use, you know, going to give you an IV? Do people know what that, I mean, people not in the field, does that, they know that IV is an intravenous or a, you know, a shot that, you know, puts liquid in your arm or something? IV could be a plant or it could be something else. We use a lot of acronyms, which are letters representing full words, like CAT scan. We use words in different ways, and I don't know if this will translate, but at least in the U.S., we might say, I'm feeling blue. What does that mean? I'm sad. Now, what does that have to do with the color blue? I have no idea, but when we're dealing with people from other languages and abilities, we want to use the real use of words, not those regional ones or those idioms. So those are just a few examples, but now it's your turn. I promise this is all about you. On page 4 of your handout, I have some examples of words, and some of these are taken from materials that Andrew sent me even. They're not unusual words, they're pretty common words. What I would like, let's try it as a group. Let's pick one. And we'll see how we explain it clearly and simply. Anyone have a favorite? I'll pick. How about, because I've heard this term over here a lot, healthy lifestyle. You like that one, huh? How can you say that in plain language? I don't know what you mean by healthy lifestyle. I mean, I'm guessing, but I might be wrong. Explain it to me. I am the newcomer to your country. I'm Exhibit A. Put it in plain language for me. And there's no right and wrong. I hope that you feel comfortable in this time to try things out and be a little silly and, you know, we're just figuring it out together, which is what plain language is all about. There's no right or wrong, and just feel good about just the fact you tried.
Being fit.
Being fit. Oh, well, being fit, like I fit into my clothes. So tell me, well, let's finish that. Being fit, what this could be.
Being physically and mentally fit.
Being active. Fitting into my clothes works too. But yes.
Eat right.
Pardon?
Exercise.
Eat right. Exercise.
Don't miss out on anything, but do not indulge.
Do not indulge. Okay. Did you want to add something? Thank you.
Eating and
sleeping and getting rest, eating and sleeping.
Okay. And avoid smoking and alcohol.
Thank you. Well, listen to all this. So this was just a healthy lifestyle. So some of you talked about eating, sleeping, drinking, your physical, your mental. For that simple word that didn't have a lot of syllables to it, we actually meant a lot of different things in there. That's the hard part of plain language, when we no longer, this might be considered jargon.
Staying healthy.
So that may be a way to do it. So what does that mean? You know, staying healthy. So that could be. So we want to explain it because the person reading this or hearing this needs to know, does this mean I can't drink? Does this mean I need to change my food or something else? So what I might do, I might build on that. I might use more words. A healthy lifestyle means ways to stay healthy, period. That includes eating healthy foods, getting some exercise every day, getting good sleep, you know, something like that. So I might explain it a little bit more. So that's an example of plain language. Plain language, no one promises that it will be shorter. It often is. You saw the flu example, it was shorter, but I got rid of a lot. And that's the hard part about plain language, is letting go. So that is the hard part. But once you do it, then start raising your sensitivity there to what might someone else not know what you're really talking about that. We did a great job. Let's try one more. Pick one. Anyone. What other word do you want to work on? Pardon?
Tested positive.
Tested. That, why do we say that? Tested positive.
This is where the technical jargon comes. Tested positive, layman will not understand. I mean, okay, if you are going continuously positive, then you will know. Otherwise, plain and simple language, if you say, the, whatever within the tolerance, you are positive for this particular disease.
And isn't it a strange term? Because it sounds like, ta-da, that's good, I'm positive. But it doesn't mean good news, it means bad news. Yes. It why we do this to language, I don't know, but we do. Yes.
If I say tested positive, I feel this concern, it would be good news.
Will be good news for you, yes.
If I said tested positive for diabetes, I would
bad news.
It would be bad news. Yes. Yes. So you know what? With the wonderful examples, it could be good.
In India, tested positive could also mean that you really been tested.
It's what? I'm missing that one.
That the tests were positively done.
This is harder than I thought. Okay.
The tests have been done.
The test tested positively. It's either really good news or really bad news, or the lab was okay. So how do you give me a sentence? Just give me an example, please, of how this would be used. I read this somewhere. Give me an example of how this might have actually been used.
Okay, we can say that you just tested your HIV test and it's come out positive. I mean, the idea that you're trying to convey is that whatever the patient had come to you for, like if a patient has come for hepatitis B or hepatitis C, and I is aware that it could be either B or C, so we can say that we were suspecting hepatitis B, but sadly it's still positive.
Okay, so you use the word sadly, so you gave some context to it. You talked about context too, whether it's getting pregnant when that's what you most want in this world, or it's whether you have some disease that you really don't want to have. So those are the things, that's what makes plain language writing hard. I just want to tell you, I've been doing this for years, but I also like doing puzzles. I love doing crossword puzzles. I don't know who else here likes to do word puzzles or things. I find that this is a real puzzle to figure out what's wrong and come up with a clear way to word it. It's hard, and when you begin doing it, it takes much longer and it's much harder than it gets over time. It does get easier. So I don't know, does anyone want to try an example of how you might restate tested positive? Well, what would you two say? It's good news. How would you two?
You can have patients tell us. The test is positive. The test is positive.
Okay.
But the reason for that is because we counsel them before they done the test. And once you do the test, this is what the results versus being. If it's so much, that means it's negative. And if it's so much, it's going to be positive. So they're not dependent on me to interpret the result for them.
Okay.
They already know that it's either going to be. So we're trying to prepare them even before the result comes, rather than wait till after. Because then a problem is once you get a result, then you wait for the doctor to get back to you. And then you have all that suspense and you don't know what the level means or whether it's good or bad, and the doctor may be on holiday or anything else. Whereas here, if you've told the patient in advance that this is what we expect, then I think it's that much easier, and then the patients And it helps me to confirm that the patient understood. You know, suppose the patient says, you know, my test is positive and actually it's not, that means I didn't do a good job explaining to her in the first place what a positive. So the next patient I counsel, perhaps I'll do a
good job. Good. So it's really that education is just key in it, so that goes together with the plain language. So thank you for all that. That's just an example of how hard it is.
Do you want to? It's easier to say that you have tested to be outside the normal limits. Tested positive is outside the normal limits. Limits for the healthy people.
You could.
That's another way of explaining that the person is out of these limits, so not healthy.
But for someone who might have trouble with math, a lot of people have trouble kind of. Is without the normal limits, is that a term that you learn in advanced math, or is that a term that somebody with a primary school education might understand? What do you? I know you've done work with people at all literacy levels and two languages.
We actually, you know, positive is a term that's used for certain tests like strep and pregnancy, HIV, you know, those kind of things. But we got away from, you know, using positive or negative. Because it's so subjective. We instead started using normal and not normal.
Oh.
And I think that is accepted, you know, even people with low literacy or non-English speaking people tend to understand that better in my experience.
Good, thank you.
In our hospital, we use the term universal precautions. So if the person is tested positive for HIV and if he's coming in the operation theater, there is a placard put on the door of the operation theater, a universal precautions. So it's not announced that he's HIV positive.
Oh, okay. All right.
So the personnel who is in direct contact, hands-on with that patient, knows that universal precautions have to be taken while dealing with that patient.
So in that situation, the person doesn't even need to know positive or negative. I mean, that's a different issue. They're going to see you for knee surgery.
Yeah, for an orthopedic surgery.
Yeah.
Patient knows, and the anesthetist, they have discussed with him. This is more to deal with the healthcare personnel.
Okay.
So that they, rather than term of patient HIV positive, which is a very bad label to put, it's universal precaution. So it could be Hep B or HIV or any of the communicable
diseases, okay.
Which need precautions. So
okay.
We enter with eyeglasses and.
So that's interesting. That's so one case that's actually to use those words and use more jargon because that's what you need in that situation.
Yeah, but then using those words which have more of jargon probably for healthcare professionals is fine. Then we are trying to convey the message to a layperson.
Well, the jargon is among ourselves, right? Yes. It's not to the patient.
It's not for the patient.
Right. So that's a difference. Some is for the patient. You did your education. You put it into context. You use normal, not normal. You might use within outside limits. There's no rules. What the key part is that you test it with your readers. Yes?
Just for a layman, wouldn't it be okay just to say you have the symptoms of the disease?
That's what I was thinking too.
Why not say just say you are not healthy?
No, but they come for a specific test.
So it shows that you are not healthy. Yeah, but a positive pregnancy test, a positive pregnancy test, how can you say that you are not healthy?
No,
but could
again, there is a context.
Could you just say you have cancer? You have diabetes? Yes.
I agree that things have to be taken in context. As in the pregnancy case, you have to say this is a positive or negative. But today in pathology labs, we are not using tested positive for serology, particularly HIV, HPS, and beta, VDR. Instead, we use the term reactive or non-reactive.
Okay.
Because general people don't understand these words, but positive and negative, everybody understands. And they sometimes hype it up. So it is the clinician's prerogative to explain to the patient if they are reactive, what is the situation. So it remains only between the clinician and the patient.
Thank you. And then I'd go back to your point of just doing that education. And if reactive, not reactive are the key words, then you have to explain them. Positive, negative, you have, normal, not normal. It was a range. That's why, that's the art part.
But I wish to add, you know, I've seen many cases all over Bombay and India also. I've seen reports where it's written CRF. A patient is not even aware that they've got chronic renal failure. And the creatinine is 7. And the doctors have not thought it fit to inform the patient that you've got CRF. And we just write CRF, it's written, and creatinine 7. And the patient, la la la, I'm drinking water, I'm enjoying protein, I'm having chicken. And I say, you're suffering from chronic renal failure, and you're a fourth stage or fifth stage kidney failure. So I think what is missing is, the doctors are not spelling it out in black and white. That you have chronic renal failure. Chronic renal failure means kidney failure. Don't say renal because he's uneducated. You should say, aapki kidney kharab ho gayi hai, aapko dhyan rakhna hai. I get patients from mere doctor ne bola, aap 10 liter paani piyo. You know, that sort of thing.
And that's what, just remember what it's like from the reader's perspective. I just want to tell you that I have these booklets here. I'm going to end up giving them to Anju for the health library, but you're welcome to look at these later. I worked with the National Cancer Institute in the U.S. writing a lot of materials in plain language. These are some of the most widely read books, and they have won actually plain language awards where we've put together this information. One is Radiation Therapy in You, one is Chemotherapy in You, and one is Eating Hints before, during, and after cancer treatment. You can see, if you want to look at these later, examples about putting some really hard information into plain language. It is possible to do it. Let's move on to sentences, because that's an important part. So sentences, there's a little worksheet on page 5. But basically, in sentences, what you want, there's no magic absolute number of how many words to have in a sentence, but ideally you would have maybe up to 15 or 20. I actually like to mix in a few very short sentences too, so it's not all so choppy, it's a little easier to read. What you really want to do is make sure that you have one main idea and one main action in that sentence. Don't have all those punctuation, don't have all those commas and semicolons and idea after idea after idea. In schmushed, do you know the word schmushed? How about this?
In plain language?
In plain language. All put together. This is it. This works. Gestures. My husband said I use my hands too much. But, you know, you just put things and you just wait a long time till you get that period. That might work when you're writing beautiful prose for your novel, but that's not what we're doing here. So you want to make your point, you want to use an active voice. An active voice identifies who is doing the action. The opposite is a passive voice. Active voice is, Pat is baking the cake. Passive is, a cake is being baked. It doesn't even identify who it is. It's harder to read, it's harder to understand, and it never lets you know who is doing the action. Something I notice in a lot of health materials are sentences that have a lot of if and then in them. Do you see those in your materials? If this happens, then this happens. And if this happens, then that happens. I think that's because that's what healthcare is about. It's a lot of it is based on this condition or that condition. But it's a hard sentence to read, especially if you start off with, if, da-da-da-da-da, comma, then, da-da-da-da-da, period. That the person who's not a strong reader needs to understand all that stuff with the if, and then they need to understand all that stuff with the then, and they have to put it together. That's harder to do. I like to say things, like the sentence might be, if it will rain, then bring an umbrella. I think it's easier to say, it may rain, period, bring an umbrella. So there are times you can get rid of those if-thens. You can't always get rid of those if-thens. We don't all agree. I like to do the action first, like bring an umbrella because it may rain. So I like to say the action at the beginning of the sentence. Remember, where people pay attention is the beginning. Some other people who do this work is a lot say they like the context first. It may rain, then bring an umbrella. So there's no right or wrong on that. I have my preference on it. Sometimes you're writing something that has a lot of the if and then information. I did a lot of work for a group writing about amputations. And they were talking about bathroom safety for people with different levels of amputations. So you can have an above elbow amputation, below elbow, above knee, below knee. And that was a lot of if you have this, then do this. It got very complicated. So in that case, what we did is a very simple table. Just two columns. If you have, and then on the left was this kind of an amputation, then, and then on the right was what to do. So you can just find what you're looking for. So tables can be hard to read. In that case, I think it made it easier to read. So let's just try a sentence here, but I want to move along. Okay, I'm going to vote that we work on in a group as sentence number one on page 5. I didn't make these sentences up. This is the real thing. Let's see what you think of this sentence and how we might make it a little simpler. Is it clear? Is it simple?
It's not simple.
It's not simple. What's hard?
Only one sentence.
The whole thing is one sentence?
This could be divided into three sentences, simple sentence.
Okay. Do you need all the information that's there? Could you?
No. All the information is available.
Okay.
But only thing, understanding is slightly different.
Okay.
Only
so
because here the communication is, you will be taken to the radiologist, he will test you, he will give you one brain which contains barium, and with the aid of this barium, radiologist will see your stomach movement.
So you just did it in a list, you did it in a sequence.
Yeah.
So you did the time order, which again, thinking from the reader's perspective, what's that order of information? So you did that right away, you did short action ones. And did you notice what else he did? He said, you will be given barium.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Did he say, you will be given a pleasantly flavored drink?
No.
Is barium, who here has had barium? Is it pleasant?
Not pleasant.
That's what I was getting at too, was I think we need to be honest. Not everything in medicine is a pleasure. And if we start by not telling the truth, even though it's nicer to write that, are we doing a good service for anybody? So what did you think of what he suggested?
Are you going to say you would be given an unpleasantly flavored?
Do you say, and this will only hurt a little bit?
I would ask, what is barium?
You would ask, what is barium? Okay. And would you want to know what it tastes like? Why are you having barium? So she wants to know something different, which is why. So then you could focus on that.
You may add edible drink which contains barium.
Okay.
Which is needed to see your stomach.
Which is what?
Needed to see your stomach movement.
Which is needed to see your stomach movement.
Moment of flavor barium. In your stomach will be observed by radiologist using fluoroscopy.
Okay, do you need the word fluoroscopy?
Explain.
Yeah, do you need it?
Right.
Just
leave it at that. If they ask for the explanation,
okay,
using the passive voice. Pardon? He's using the passive voice.
Yeah. And second thing, the patient doesn't know this, what is fluoroscopy or what exactly instrument. Because he knows only they have, we are into the hand of, doctors, so they are using instruments, so that is understood. Only thing, what action is there, so you need to know that, and that is not harmful to me.
Okay, so you're bringing up are such wonderful points, yes. To see your stomach. Sorry, I have an allergy to all those syllables. Yes. Yes. So there's your yes.
I might say that.
Say it so we can all hear it, please.
Patient might then get frightened and say the doctor can take me.
So did you hear that? So we've got all these different perspectives. The first document I ever worked on in plain language, I was working at this hospital, and there was a whole team of us, doctors, lawyers, patient education, library, everybody was there. And we tried to rewrite the consent form that every patient coming into the hospital signed. And we went through conversations like you're having now. But you could say this, but does that mean that? Do this and that? It took forever to go through this one sheet. But we learned so much by doing it. That process does get easier. And I recommend that if you are the writer, you're going to do this a lot, you might be looking for, create your own glossary of simpler words. There actually, and I didn't bring my iPhone with me, there actually is an app for that. There's an app that has simple word substitution from the National Library of Medicine. Andrew, if you email me and remind me, I can send you the name of the app. The University of Michigan put it together. It's not the perfect answer, but it might just help. The thing that I do when I try to write in plain language, because sometimes I get stuck, I get really stuck. What I find helps is I say it aloud, even if I'm all alone in a room and it feels kind of silly. I say it aloud, and if it doesn't speak, come out clearly, I have a problem with writing it, and that will help me figure it out. So you're great sports. Let's move on just a little more in plain language. I want to get to some other strategies. Is that okay with you? We'll just go through the other ones, and I want to get to a few others too. So the next part, I don't think I have an activity for the next one. You have to go back to page 3 when I just go kind of some overall suggestions of what to do. So we tried a few activities. So we talked about sentences. Numbers are so hard. People may struggle to read, but they have even more trouble with math, almost always. So really watch the numbers. If you can be doing math for people, if you really need numbers, there's just some hints there for it, and that's just the beginning. Sometimes I do whole workshops just about numbers and numeracy. It's just a big, big issue. In fact, I just took a 3.5-day course from the National Institute for Health on how to communicate scientific data to the public. And my head was like, whoa, I'm not sure I understand this. It's that hard. Tone, you want to watch your tone. Again, if you want to check back that flu example I did, as much as possible, speak directly, write directly to your reader using the word you and your. I try to do that in the first sentence. So here is the radiation. Started with about this book. You notice we don't use introduction. There's no need, we have to have that fancy word about this book. First sentence, radiation therapy in you is written for you. Someone who is about to get or is now getting radiation therapy for cancer. The next sentence is, people who are close to you may also find this book helpful. I'm speaking to the reader right from the beginning because it really is all about the reader. I was also identifying the audience. You want to frame information in as positive yet honest a way that gets to that barium. You want to consider your reader's logic, life experience, really understanding of this, and be specific whenever you can rather than get a moderate amount of exercise. You might say, walk for 20 minutes every day or something like that. So don't leave it up to the person's judgment, so the other person knows what to do. As far as format, layout, and graphics, that's very important how something looks. What you want to do, headers are very good. You can see in all my work, just look at the handout. You've got things in bold. Those are headers or subheadings. Why do I do that? It's not just me. Why do we do that? They act like road signs. You know where to look. You don't even have to read the same thing. Remember, a lot of people don't like to read, don't want to read, are not interested in this. So they know where to look. You want to, dotted lists, I use them a lot, but try not to have very long dotted lists. If you have more than about six items, have two lists. You know, like, here's a whole list of fruit, could be very long, but here's a list of melons and, you know, apples or something. You want to have adequate white space. What is that? I mean, you know when pages look too crowded, right? So maybe about a 50-50 mix. So it gives your eye some way to relax. The white space also is kind of like a time to catch your breath. So we can act almost like a header in there too. You want to have big enough size type. Generally, that's at least a 12 point. If you're writing for an older audience, people with visual impairments, generally you go about 14. Sometimes people just do the small, real small types, they can fit it on a piece of paper. I don't know about you, but I need reading glasses. Do you find small type? I don't even bother. I can't see it. Line things up on the left, but not also on the right, and don't center them. That gives your eye always starts from the same place there. Also, I'm really a fan, and many people in plain language are using upper and lowercase letters, not all capital letters. You might have heard, what an email, they say, don't use all caps, it's shouting. I don't know where that came from. Maybe it is, maybe it's not. The reason is, we have this. So I'm telling you that I went to Africa and I saw some animals. And I saw this animal. Okay? You're squinting at it. You can't quite see it. What does it look like? Could be an animal. A great big rectangle. They're all the same size, right? If I do it in lowercase, and you were squinting, but I told you it's about my trip to Africa, do you think you might have figured out it was an elephant? No? Some letters go up, some go down, some go part way up. That's what it does. It gives you this visual cue, okay? And that's what it can do. The other languages you're dealing with, I don't know what to say about that, and I've seen the languages, so I don't know if they're all the same height. But that's just something, if you have the possibility, vary the heights, that really helps. Graphics can help. We're going to talk about graphics a little bit more, line them up by the idea, and encourage reader interaction, like checklists, quizzes, something else like that. So that's a quick tour of plain language. What are you thinking? You think it's possible for what you're doing? If you could put some of it into plain language? For you producers and polishers? Yeah. I suggest you give it a try. It will be hard at first. There's no doubt about it. It's a different way of writing. But what about the benefit of it? You think?
No, I didn't get the question.
For using plain language in your work, do you think it's something you might try?
Yeah, like if I want to describe a mind, if I use the, like metaphor, mind is like a donkey. Monkey. Or mind is like a child. So it conveys that child is not, it goes from here and there. Monkey also goes, hops from one place to another.
I'm so glad you said that, because that's going right to the next section on metaphors. That's perfect. I encourage you to give it a try. You know what? I'm going to pass these around in different directions. feel free to look at them. And if you can end up giving them to Andrew, would you like them for the library? Okay. So you can just see one way of doing this in plain language.
Can you know one more thing? I think sometimes things are hard to understand. It's because the person who's explaining them is not very clear himself. And sometimes if you're a little confused and you're not really sure, you know, there are certain things in medicine which you either slept through in medical college or you didn't really particularly attend. And then when that comes up, and that happens even for gynecologists, there's certain fields like immunology or genetics which you don't understand too much about, so you then to kind of bleep over them. And then, because you don't understand it very clearly yourself, it's obviously that much harder to explain to a patient. But you don't want to tell the patient you don't understand. So then you cloak your ignorance by using complex stuff so that it inhibits the patient from asking questions. And I honestly think, that doctors are either complexifiers, and they make things so complex that you're just a stupid patient, you're not going to understand anything. You just leave it all up to me. Or they have the confidence to be able to simplify it. So then the patient knows exactly what you're talking about. I was wondering how many patients here had that experience. Especially people, for example, from the V-care support group, when you had cancer and people have spoken to you. Has anyone had that experience? Or is it sometimes the doctors just make things so complicated because they don't understand stuff clearly themselves?
Many times patients do come to us and they say the doctors don't have time to explain it to us. So please do explain as urgency. Like our counselors, when they are there in the hospital, patients go with the whole lot of files. And they say, ma'am, please see what it is written. Please explain us what the drug is about. The doctor has no time to even, he's given us a gist everything. He's told us to take the medicine morning and afternoon. But then what exactly it is? What will be the side effects of it? Even, a little like a diagnosis written also, even so much of a doctor's term, the patient wants to understand that. It's like, a word like palliative. Palliative chemo is there. Initially everybody is like, palliative means your treatment is over, everything is done. But when they come and say, but the doctor has told us to give palliative chemo, how is it going to help? At the end, the patient is going to die. But they don't understand that the lifestyle of the patient is going to change even after the chemo. Maybe the death will be a little simpler, not very painful. And the reason behind giving it is that the patient shouldn't suffer more. So I guess patients have a lot of apprehensions and a lot of questions after coming out of the doctor's cubicle somewhere.
What happens is, it's under education. A simple example is spinal pain. Many people suffer from it, and they say, we've got to the best of doctors, Leelavati guy, and they come with reports. And I say, what happened? What did your doctor? No, he says, there's no problem. I said, there is a problem. You got osteophytes. Now the doctor has not taken the pain and the care to educate the patient, look, osteophytes have grown in your spine. They're going to continuously give you pain. So please bear with the pain, or there's nothing that we can do. My doctor says, there's no problem. I said, no, there is a problem. So the main thing is under education from the medical side to the patient. Everything is mentioned. You are very smart. Doctors are smart. Very good. I love it. But the education is not going down to the patient.
Thank you. I think you raise an important point. I think a lot of times we hide behind all our syllables because we don't quite understand that. But for anyone doing the communication here, I don't know if anyone is thinking about worried or thinking, what's she talking about? Are you worried that it's going to take longer to explain it clearly? Not only the time of figuring out how to write it, but if you tell somebody what really will happen, that conversation will take longer?
Yes. That's one of the apprehensions for the doctor who doesn't understand. To write something so simple that it will be understood, it will increase more questions.
Right.
So they would rather hide behind it.
My observation is, I may be wrong. One is the doctor's education for 5 to 7 years and the medical terms and big books and all these things. Then they're used to use that language. That is one part. Second thing, when you deal with the patient, the their subconscious mind, they are thinking that I am superior. And many a time, if I don't use this language, the patient may think he doesn't know.
Right. And then,
it's a vague statement, but could be.
And I've heard that many times in places. It really takes a confident person to speak in plain language. It really, really does. And the other part is that when people worry about time, and it is a real worry, it's a worry around the world. I mean, it's a real concern. Nobody has enough time. However, studies have been done about this, and I can't cite them right now. But if you explain it clearly and simply the first time, it will take less time later on. Now, in the U.S., we're dealing with lack of payment if a patient is readmitted to the hospital within 30 days. They're just saying, we will not pay for that. That is a reason to explain it more clearly the first time, because it will cost more later. You're going to get phone calls, you're going to get readmissions, you're going to have a much sicker patient. So yes, it does take longer, but people are afraid that it's going to take a lot longer. It doesn't need to take a lot longer. You can cut that time a bit. It will take a little longer, but it won't take a longer
time. I'd like to add, in India, I'm speaking from experience. There was a case of multiple sclerosis with the involvement of the brain and the spine together in London. She went instantly blind in half an hour, sitting in front of a computer. They took her down to the hospice. Her brother was the manager in Barclays Bank. They invited him. Within 1 hour, they diagnosed it as multiple sclerosis, involvement of the spine and the brain. And the patient files came to me from England. And the family came to India with those reports. And it was mentioned that the patient was seen at this time. And the family was given a computer. They were informed of all the websites of multiple sclerosis. They were given around 250 pages of printouts with signature. And they brought those 250 pages to me from England. And I was shocked. They said, yes, this happened in 1 hour. Diagnosis with the printout of all the associations connected with multiple sclerosis in the world. So that's the type of information that was given to that patient. In India, we don't even give it in 10 years that you suffer from this problem.
Well,
what's the use?
No. At least they were aware. Aware.
It's just like critical
No, sir. At least the family was aware of what they were treating. In India, they're running from pillar to post because you're not giving them proper diagnosis and the proper information about their problem. Unko pata lag gaya multiple sclerosis hai. So they were given the necessary palliative care that the government could pay for in Ireland.
Can we reframe this? Because I think, yes?
There could be many reasons why the doctor doesn't explain it properly. One thing may be thinking that the patient may not be able to understand. Second thing, the doctor may be overloaded with his work. So he's trying to shortcut the time. If he doesn't explain to every patient, how is he going to complete his work?
No.
And then when we talked about, I don't know if you were here this morning, that health literacy and health communication is two-way, the patients and the providers, and we can start blaming one part, blaming the other, the patient can't read, the provider doesn't have enough time, you know, doesn't care. We can do all that. I really believe that we can make it better. We can't make it perfect, and we're not going to make it perfect by tomorrow. But if we can make it a little bit better, so I'd like to kind of keep going that way rather than figuring out who is at fault for it. So it's a hard problem, and I often say we are all part of the problem, because we are, but we are also all part of the solution. So can we move on to metaphors? I want to do that very briefly, and I want to do stories very briefly, and then have a little bit of time for visuals. Is that okay?
Yes.
All right. Metaphors. They're also maybe called analogies or similes. What it really is comparing something familiar with something unfamiliar. You talked about a child who's like a monkey. Well, they're not like a monkey totally, but they're like in certain ways. So what is it, those Venn diagrams, you know, the circles that overlap? It kind of like finds that overlapping place between one concept and another concept. You have your unfamiliar term, for example, you have your familiar one. Often they're put together with a like or as. You may not have to say it. I often describe a metaphor is like the outside and corner pieces of a jigsaw puzzle. It puts that familiar framework to all those unfamiliar pieces that go inside. Did you get it? A metaphor. What was that? What did I do to explain that? I used my hands. It's visual. To me, it's very visual. It's tactile almost. So it's a real everyday example to be doing that. I've learned a lot about metaphors from this Dr. Terry Rule, who's in Pennsylvania, has this wonderful website called the Altoona List of Medical Analogies. And you can go to the website, the link is here, and see how people have done this in many different ways. But I want to read you a few. And they answer many questions. But I don't know if you're dealing with this. I assume we are worldwide. Is that you don't want to keep giving antibiotics. I mean, that's a real big problem now. You want to give antibiotics only when they're absolutely needed. So these metaphors try to answer that question. Why don't we use antibiotics for colds, acute bronchitis, and other viral illnesses? These are just some examples. You don't use bug spray to kill weeds in your lawn. Using antibiotics for viruses is like using a large net to catch minnows. They just go through the holes. Using antibiotics for viruses is like putting gas in your gas tank if your battery is dead. Treating a cold with antibiotics is like using an umbrella to stay warm in winter. It just doesn't work. And when it starts to rain, your umbrella may be worn out. What do you think of those? Do they get the message across? That's a hard concept to explain, I think.
Yeah, I think it's beautifully, most of the sentences make sense.
And the other part to it, do you have minnows here? I've never fished and I don't know minnows. So, it's very small. Yeah, little tiny ones. But what this does, and the reason I chose these few, is they're put in cultural context. If I was dealing with fisher people from, you know, a place that did a lot of fishing and where they have minnows, that would make a lot of sense. Me, I understand the gas in the car or the umbrella a whole lot better. Or the bug spray, especially if you're a camper or the bug spray or living in an area that's hot all the time. You know, so there's different ways. What you're doing is you're personalizing it to that person. You're making it relevant, making that point right there. You don't use metaphors for everything. Okay, thank you. Nice meeting you. Glad you came. There's some suggestions of what to do about metaphors. Decide when it's needed. You are not going to explain everything. You know, the common cold, people get it. You use it for important concept. You explain it with terms or words that people really know. You don't want to add confusion to it. You explain the metaphor. You give the fuller example, like an aneurysm is like a garden hose with a hole in it. But an aortic aneurysm is not like a garden hose, because an aortic aneurysm happens in just this part of the body, where a garden hose can get a hole anywhere. So you want to explain the difference, and then you want to move on. You do not want to keep talking about a garden hose. So, okay, so that's just one more tool. A lot of people like metaphors because they're very short.
They're short and they're very effective. The one I use for people with osteoarthritis to lose weight is that your body is like a truck which is designed to carry a ton of material. If you have 2 tons, your tires are going to wear off.
Oh, I love that. Great.
And people immediately connect it and start working on their weight.
Okay, you gave me inspiration. Let's try one, because sometimes if we had more time, I'd play this whole game and have lots of time to do it. Somebody just shout out something you want to explain that's hard for people to understand. Something you really do explain.
I typically speaking, when I have a pregnant mother, who has gone beyond the due date that is given to her for the delivery.
Okay, so can we just use it as an example?
The risks of what could happen to her. I typically use a metaphor. I say that it is like overripe fruit. So the test may go down. So in the same way, there could be problems with the pregnancy. That goes very well in the patient.
I'm just going, we just had a grandbaby born, and the mom was a week overdue, but I wouldn't want it to break to turn into a prune.
You know, in one discussion, somebody asked me, can you explain God? Then I shared him, God is like a petrol. Because petrol is same for Mercedes, for simple car. Or a 20 years car also, I mean after 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
One will go with the 150 kilometers per hour, one will go with the 20 kilometers per hour. Petrol is same.
Uh-huh.
Petrol gives energy to the car.
Mm-hmm.
One car will meet with the accident, one will go safely. It is like a God. It gives you energy, you are in the driver's seat. Whatever it's your life, you can do whatever. God will give you only energy.
You know, for all, thank you. I mean, we don't need to play the game. You people are really great on doing all these, and some of them are really memorable. So that's just the point of it. When I give these talks, sometimes a lot, in fact, I did this once at Harvard Medical School, those students who were so busy. And I think they just came away with, like, this is something I can teach in, like, one sentence. I mean, it doesn't, two sentences, whatever your truck, yours took a little longer, you know. It doesn't take that long, and especially if you're always talking about pretty much the same thing, you have a way to connect with the patient, you know, with the other person. The person drives a car, the person, you know, rides a bike or something. It just makes it a little more personal. So thanks for trying that. Stories is the next part, and I'm really not, there's so much to stories, but I think I've met so many people who are such wonderful storytellers. I opened this morning with a story. Do you remember my story? Seems like a long time ago, didn't it? I talked about the first time I heard about health literacy.
1995.
In that house with those
I'm sorry, my husband's here. This man listened to me. Okay, yes, 1995. Why did I open with a story? Pardon?
You wanted to share that experience or that moment?
I wanted to share that experience, yes. Why else?
The story is like interesting listening.
Interesting listening. Mm-hmm. In that story, I was the one who had kind of screwed up, right? Because I didn't explain things clearly. So why did I tell that part?
You relate yourself in that story.
Because it happened to me, I've been through it, people here are just starting to learn, so to make it more human. So, and I also use stories in a way to introduce myself. We listen to many speakers, I'm sure you've heard many speakers many times, and we all have a style of doing it, and my style always is, that's the way I introduce myself, is to kind of tell a little story, not a very big one, just a little one, to say, this is my way of doing it, but they make a point, so they're not just a story to tell a story. To tell a story, it does make a point. I mean, I get impatient listening to people who just tell stories, and it just kind of like, where's this going? If we're doing, I mean, it's fine if it's a friend, a family member, but you know, I want, if it's a presentation, I want to make sure it's going, or in written information. Your book is filled with a lot of stories too, your new book. Stories have a beginning, a middle, and an end, but not always in that order. It usually involves a setting. What was the setting in my story? A hospital in Boston. The characters was myself, but I also described the patients. What was the obstacles? People couldn't understand the worksheets. And what was the resolution?
you started thinking, well, how can I?
Yes, thank you.
Understand that.
Yes. So, you know, I started going down this journey of health literacy.
And it turned into your passion then.
And I turned it into a passion. You're a wonderful listener. Thank you. So you can tell stories that are your own stories. You can use them from folk tales, from news, from experience. But you want to leave people in an okay place. You don't want to tell stories that, you know, leave people in a really uncomfortable place. So you want to tell the story, get to the point. You can use them in many settings. Do stories appeal to everybody? Well, maybe not, but I think they appeal to an awful lot of people. It's just a tool that you can use to bring in the humanity of it. You can use them in print. You can use them in conversation. You can use them in media. I think we had some reporters here. I don't know if you write stories. You can tell about like one person's experience. The first speaker this morning talked about two patients. Number one, who had the stent, who had the catheter in, and he delivered. With you. Yes, you started right away with a story. Do you always start with a story?
Yeah, most often.
And why do you do that?
That makes the presentation very interesting.
It did make it, and very memorable, and interesting. And you
catch the attention quite quickly and fast.
Yes. So you use that, do you use that in your presentations?
Yeah.
Do you use stories any other way? Do you do anything in print? Do you write articles?
Yes.
Do you tell stories there?
Yes. In the book that is published this time, I have used a couple of stories as case studies.
We share our experiences with our patients, document it. When we get a diabetic, we show them the past patients, ulcerative colitis, any type of patients that we get.
Yes.
We try to update, because we are treating with alternate medicine. So many people who come to us with a, you know, skeptical frame of mind. They're not sure if they'll get their money's worth.
So you're trying to kind of show about that. Somebody else this morning was talking about the role of immunization, polio immunization, and so showed some example. How do you use stories? Because I think you were a real believer in stories from your book, aren't you? You?
I think the best thing I try to do is get my patients to share their stories with other patients. So then they have much more validity rather than coming from me. They can hear it. So we have a section on our website called Success Stories. So I think that acts like a source of inspiration to other patients. That's been there, and there's light at the end of it.
Thank you. And those, are they videos? Or are they print? Are they videos? Are they audios?
Whatever the patient's comfortable with. Some of them are okay with the
story. So really, what that does is that sense of personal relevance. And we talked about information has to be what people can know, do, and feel. A story can often get to that feeling place.
You get emotionally attached, because when I hear his story, when he presented, immediate reaction was, first thing is anger. When catheter is removed.
I mean anger at the patient.
Worry and all these things. So emotionally you get attached.
Yes, you do. So. Just one more way, when you communicate, you may not use all these ways, and there are so many other ways, and the person was here about games. I mean, there's just an unlimited ways to communicate, but this just gives you that much more ways to do it. I would think a metaphor is almost like a short story in there. You can say it in one or two sentences and kind of get to the essence. It's not the same in there. So that's what stories are about. You can use them all sorts of ways. You want to look at some visuals? Okay, we'll have some more fun with this. So there are all kinds of visuals. I want to show you some examples. So what key do I press on the computer? That's good. If that was the thing I needed to teach, look at that. Okay, can I sit here and because I think the computer person's done. I'm going to sit here and just show you some of these. So there's all kinds of visuals. We've been using visuals since the beginning of time, almost, the hieroglyphics. Everyone learns from visuals, and I wanted to show you this. So we might be thinking, well, visuals is just kind of like for those who can't read or something. I was at this conference, mostly all with doctors, and at the breakfast buffet, I was meeting with this doctor of pediatric neurology. And I said, oh, and I believe a lot in pictures. She said, so do I. She drew this. This is actually on the napkin at the place where we had breakfast. You can see the background? It's on the napkin. She drew this picture. And this is on pediatric neurodevelopment. A 2 month smiling head control, 4 months reaching, rolling over, 6 months, see, going down the spinal column, neurodevelopment. She teaches this at medical school. This is what she, you know, not on a napkin, she draws it out or do something. Doctors come back to her years later and say, you're the one who drew the picture. Medical students. Pictures can, everyone can learn from pictures. I had to take neurology. I would have done a whole lot better with that one. And now that we have the new grandbaby, I showed my daughter-in-law this picture. She has a much clearer sense of what to expect in the baby's development over the first year. So everyone can learn from pictures. This is another example. This was from a diabetes guide. It's an excellent one from put out by the American College of Physicians. It's really written in a very, very clear way. What I especially liked, what I wanted to show you that, is it's real food and real pictures. I mean, and real people. You know, there's usually like the drawings or something. And actually they have little quotes, little anecdotes. Those are like a mini version of a story in there. With the bottom one, the guy is saying, when I go for seconds, I go for the vegetables. They really fill me up. So isn't that some version of a story that's in there? So there's photographs too. They didn't have much money to produce that, so they just took real food and took the camera and did it. Let's see what else we have here for examples. This one is from a cookbook for children called Pretend Soup and Other Real Recipes. So it's just line drawing. So this is a professionally produced book, but it was how, I don't know, do you have French toast? It's bread with egg in it. But just showing children who are just learning to read how to make French toast so that the child can be the main cook with the adult helper in there. This one is from Peter Houts. It's pictographs, which he uses very much and has written a lot of papers and done a lot of research on this in healthcare. So he does simple stick figures there. And he actually did a survey of, at least for a while, HIV/AIDS medication was very complicated. I don't know if it is still. For a while, it was a lot of different medications all day long. And he did this study with people who read at about a second grade level and did a series of about 50 different drawings, and they were color-coded. And I forget the whole code, but they taught it to people, including red, yellow, and green. Red, like, you need to do something right away if this happens. Yellow, you know, you can wait till the morning, and green, whatever, call next week or something. And I don't remember what the blue was. But simple line drawings to convey this. They looked at the recall rate of what this message meant a month later. It was extraordinarily high. So there are articles in the back of your handout by Peter Houts. You can find the research. Now this is a stick figure, because I want to teach you how to draw. Who here likes to draw? Ooh, good, I can make you all unhappy. I'm going to teach you how to draw. Okay, you ever draw stick figures when you were little? Okay. So in your handout, okay, go to page 9. In one box, draw a square. In the next box, draw a circle. We don't have, yeah, we're not doing that part yet. In the next block, draw a triangle.
Apex down?
Mm-hmm. Whatever you want. You like to get an A, don't you? And next block, draw a squiggly line.
What is that?
Squiggly line. You know that word? Squiggly line. Do. Anything. Scribble. What is it? A net? Oh, a Z. Just whatever. Did everybody do all that?
Yes.
You passed. You can all draw. Yay! You have all the skills you need to draw. So this is one way of doing a stick figure. We knew this when we were kids, right? But because I know people like numbers and want to do everything just right. So I just want to show you, if you were to draw stick figures, you can begin with a square. See, this is a square up here. A square, all the numbers are the same size, so it's 1:1. See what it, am I explaining that well? So you can do that as the top part of the torso. The hip part is about half, it's the same width, but it's about half the height. For your arms, it's about the same length as each side of the square, with a little silly hand on it. Your head is about the same height, too, and your legs are about 1.5 and 1.5. So that's, if you wanted proportions, if you think, I can't draw a stick figure because I get the proportions all wrong, that's just a little way to remember how to do that. We'll get back to that one in a minute. The next one, might be my last illustration, is a salt shaker figure. I learned this, I took a webinar. It was a wonderful webinar by Mike Artell. He actually, some of you as excellent speakers might like it, he actually draws pictures in the middle of his own talks. I was so impressed by it. He even did this on a webinar. Now, he draws these figures that he refers to as a salt shaker figure that has even less to do. So does this kind of look like a salt shaker, more or less, using your imagination there? And then very simple arms. The hands can be almost like a mitten. You don't even have to have all the fingers on there. And the legs are very simple. A little head, and you can differentiate between male and female just with the hair, perhaps. And put it into context. I mean, what I might draw for a figure would be dressed the way we dress in the U.S., you might dress it a little differently, do hair a little different. You can adapt it. This takes but moments to do. Let's see, what else do I have here? Oh, see what I did with this? A salt shaker figure. You see how simple that is? I don't think that took me more than a moment to do it. So we assume that body behind it. This is how I represented hands. I don't even have the right number. We're not dealing with great works of art here. You can do a message in it and a face. That's really all you need to do if you were creating a picture. To create a picture, it's tea time. Let's see. I have in there, I'll just get through this and then we'll just give it a little, then we'll talk and we'll try something too. So you get the sense that there's different types of visuals. I didn't cover all the types, but did you get a sense? Photography, simple light and drawing, pictographs, use of colors, stick figures, salt shaker figures. You can, if you're not good at drawing at all, you can probably buy a pad and just write something on it there. Yes?
I just wanted to say, if the visuals are really representing the text, I understand that you might use this quickly, but it is really important that the visuals are quite accurate if they're representing the text.
Can you give an example, please?
Like if you were showing a woman having a mammogram, it would be really important that it actually really, the drawing represents what the writing is saying accurately.
In all situations, or do you need to, I mean, would there be times you can just talk about there is a mammogram, or if you're doing it, to, what to expect when you're going to have a mammogram? I mean, I agree with you, I'm not disagreeing with you, but I didn't know if context is the simplicity versus the detail.
There has to be a context for the visual, otherwise what's the point of having it?
Right, so usually to do this, and your materials might be different because you translate them into visuals. Is you do usually do it with simple wording, or you do it right next to the wording, and you can do simple wording underneath. Oh, thank you very much. No, I'm not going to have anything right now, but I'm going to comment on it, where you put it together with it, the simple writing underneath for it. That level of detail, it could well be that you need a lot of detail to it too, and a lot
yeah,
of accuracy.
I suppose if you're using visuals to reflect the text, it is important that they do reflect the text.
Thank you. A variety of ways. I think there's so many examples, and you can do it to reflect the text. You certainly don't want to do it that it doesn't reflect the text. Let me just go through a couple things here. So you want to have it consistent with your reader's culture and age and gender and show people at their best, and you want to have it current, like telephones or those curlicue cords probably won't mean much in this era of cell phones. Let's see what else. I wrote in here a lot of different things that you can do. I know for some time I had a little mole on one of my toes, and I went to the dermatologist and she was giving me the results, and the results weren't great, and so I started to like not pay attention. I just got all worried. But then what she did is on that white paper that was on the examining table, she like drew out the different levels of derma and showed me where my mole was, and indeed it wasn't all that bad. And seeing her visual, I could relax and listen. The one thing that she didn't do, I wish she had, is rip off the sheet and give me the visual. Because then I could have referred to it for you. You know what? It's tea time. I've done so much talking. We have had such a full day. When you're done with your tea, I suggest that you practice drawing. What do you think? And I propose that you, so we have a place in there, that you try either, we can't do a mammogram, it's just too hard. We're gonna do something real simple. Just to get the point across, on this page, number 10, you've got space to draw either a stick figure or a salt shaker. Is any figure. Or your own way. Does anybody want to volunteer to be a model? If not, I will. Okay? No right or wrong. Let's see, what should I do here? Okay, go. I'm your model. Don't make me stand here too long. You're laughing. How do you think I feel? Oh, thanks. Thanks a lot. No. No cameras. No. I quit. You're done. Look at that. Look at those. Let's see.
10 out of 10.
You won't get in. Yeah, you did the salt shaker person. What did you come up with? Yeah. Oh my goodness, we got a great artist here. You've got it from the side perspective. Yay! I've got hair and face, and I look worried, and I'm complaining, and now I'm, oh, big. What's the point in trying this? You, does someone else want to be a model? I'm not doing this one twice. Do you want to do it for each other? You want to just try little groups? Or did you get the point? Okay. All right. Oh, you're such good sports. Thank you. We talked about plain language. Talked a little bit about metaphors, stories, and drawing pictures. Knowing what you know, what do you think you'll do with all this information?
Use it in day-to-day practice for communication.
Pardon?
Use it in day-to-day practice for communication with the patients.
You think you will? What do you think you might do?
You can use it as a tool for communication with our patients.
Yeah. Can you tell us a story of how you might do that? Yeah, I'm not, you don't have to commit to anything, but just wondering if anyone might just put something into practice. Remember we talked about being a health literacy hero? Like, what might you really do? Yes? Okay, can you just speak a little bit louder?
I have someone who is not literate and is just his son has just been diagnosed with juvenile diabetes.
Okay.
And I have to explain to him what the doctor said to do because the doctor didn't give him enough knowledge about it. So it was quite difficult because we didn't know how to use the syringe. So I got a real plastic syringe and because that would be easier, you know, to have it visual aid. You know? And that's how it was, and then we tried it on a piece of sponge, you know, to show exactly, and it went. It was so clear to him how much to push into the skin because I did it on the sponge, you know. And he's managing very well. So I didn't have to speak much, but with that visual aid, I could manage.
A visual aid and a tactile aid and practice, too. Yeah. Wonderful. And
he did do it on the sponges so that he would get the right depth.
And what a difference that makes in everybody's life to do that. How long did it take you to do that teaching?
Not really long. It was hardly about half an hour, 45 minutes. But then he kept coming the next day because he wasn't sure. And unfortunately, he's also a mute. So he had to explain to me what his problem was. Being mute, it's so difficult, you know. So he's doing this, you know, how much do I push? I don't know because he was probably getting logs over there. Then I understood and then I told him how to do it.
What a beautiful story.
You know, I must say one thing. I don't think a doctor would ever have the time or the energy or the inclination or the desire to do anything. And I think it just emphasizes the fact that ordinary lay people, ordinary, extraordinary, however you think of yourself, actually have so many opportunities. We're so privileged. You know, we're well off, we're educated, we can speak English. And there's so much opportunity to share all our learning and to develop some of these things. So a simple example is to use an orange. When you're teaching someone how to give an injection, because you know the orange thickness is very similar skin. But the point is once you start doing this and then someone teaches someone else and someone and you're no longer dependent on your doctor to be doing all this teaching for you. It's just
support groups are. And we don't have support groups for everything. I've not heard of any support group for diabetes. I mean, I've heard about cancer.
Especially juvenile diabetes.
It's on the rise so much.
But it's almost there in every family.
One in five is diabetic today. Understand, what happened basically, a medical study was done in America. You must be aware about that. that why is it that when people go to alternate medicine, they get results after they come back from the doctors? Why? So this was a cause of concern for the medical fraternity in America. And they found out that the end result is when the patient comes to the alternate practitioner, they get a patient hearing. So we basically sit down with the patient and listen to them for 2 or 3 hours together. And then they feel happy that somebody is listening to them. Now when we go to a doctor, they hardly get 5 minutes. So they feel sad that we are not able to get what we want. We want a patient hearing.
Well, you talked about that too, about listening, being listened to.
Yeah, so that was why, and this is, I think it was financed by the Harvard University or one of the topmost universities in America. You can go online and read about it.
Yeah, so there are a lot of strategies. It's wonderful work that you did. It's wonderful work that everyone's doing, and you shared just some terrific stories and examples. We have it all inside of us to do all of this. These strategies are not the hardest things you've ever done. They're just not. They're not the easiest either. But what a difference they can make in somebody else's life to be doing that, to teach in ways the other person can understand. And that's just what I appreciate from this, from all of you giving up your Sunday afternoon to be here. Maybe this just reinforced the point you already knew. This may not be any new information. And what I encourage people is to say, maybe this isn't new, but I mean this most sincerely. If you're doing it, keep doing it. Maybe these were strategies you kind of thought of doing a while ago and you haven't been doing as much. Maybe you can add them back in some small way. Or maybe you found some new idea or something you can try. One that people often try is just bring a highlighter with you. You might have only that information from a drug company or something, and it's really difficult, and you don't have time to write it, and it's just not realistic. But maybe with a highlighter, you can just put out the need-to-know information relevant for that person. Each of us can make a difference. And together, we can make a big difference. So I thank you so much for being here. If I can help in any other way, you have my contact information. The back of your handout has a lot of resources, and resource leads to others. And I can't wait to hear your stories about how you've been putting this into place. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much.